This is the iFlight Nazgul Eco. It's a budget-friendly drone with all of the quality that iFlight bind flies are known for. But what compromises have been made to hit that price point? And should you consider this over a more premium bind fly option? Don't go anywhere, because that's what we're gonna talk about in this video. Drone has been on the market for a little while, and YouTube is full of Nazgul Eco reviews, but iFlight made some changes to this drone after those initial reviews were published. They changed this 3D printed antenna holder to a black one that has a captured XT60 design. Mine has the loose XT60. Second, the price has increased a little bit. You're gonna see this advertised all over YouTube as the $199 FPV drone. For the analog version, the DJI version does cost a little bit more, but unfortunately, nope, can't get that price anymore. Everything goes up in cost, I guess. If you want to check out the latest prices, because prices do change, feel free to check out the links that I've got in the video description. Those are affiliate links. I might get a small commission if you buy anything, but it doesn't cost you anything, and this is not a sponsored video. I actually chose to buy this drone because for me, the Nazgul Eco is an amazing value that I just couldn't pass up on. If you're new here, don't forget to subscribe. I wanna make sure you're here for future videos. All right, let's get into it. The Nazgul Eco comes in an analog version that has a True X frame, and I have the DJI O3 version, which comes with a dead cat frame. The analog version is gonna be a good choice for freestyle pilots and people just getting started who wanna save a little bit of money. And the dead cat version is going to be the best choice if you're interested in getting cinematic FPV shots, since you won't have props in view of your FPV camera. I did choose the version with a crossfire receiver and a GPS. Those options cost a little bit more, but for me, they're worth it. You can also get this in 2.4 gigahertz or 900 megahertz ELRS. The GPS does raise the cost a little bit, but unless you're flying freestyle and keeping things close, I highly recommend spending a few extra bucks for a pre-installed GPS. GPS Rescue has gotten so much better in Betaflight, and it can save your quad if something goes wrong or if you lose your video feed by flying behind a mountain or for whatever reason. The Nazgul Eco is based on iFlight's tried and true Nazgul frame. The arms are 5 millimeters thick, the top plate is 3 millimeters thick, and the bottom plate is 2.5 millimeters thick. It does have an aluminum camera mount up front, and it uses silicone inserts to prevent jello in your DJI O3 footage. I have used systems that use TPU to mount the DJI O3 camera, and TPU seems to be too stiff, and I've also used systems with rubber grommets, and rubber grommets can be too soft. These silicone inserts seem to work pretty well. It's just the right amount of softness to prevent jello without being too soft. There is an LED light down here that illuminates this iFlight logo, and it changes color according to your battery voltage. There is an external buzzer to help you locate your quad if you crash, and it is secured with this TPU print. It doesn't seem like it's going anywhere, but I suppose you could throw a zip tie over it if you wanted to. There is an anti-spark filter which is secured in the same TPU print that holds the receiver and the antennas. Remember, if you buy this quad today, you'll get a different print that has a captured XT60 connector. I actually prefer to have my XT60 connector loose because it gives me a little bit of freedom to move the battery forward if I need to balance center of gravity, but the captured XT60 definitely looks much cleaner. There's advantages and disadvantages to both. It's definitely not a deal breaker. The anti-spark filter is a very nice detail that I really didn't care about until I got one. I've never put one on one of my builds, but I have to admit it's very nice to have. And supposedly, it'll make your electronics last longer. Since I'm running Crossfire, I do have an iFlight 900 megahertz antenna. I also opted for GPS, and it's secured in this excellent mounting system, which we also see in the more expensive Nazgul and Chimera drones. It uses a combination of TPU parts mounted on aluminum standoffs that allows you to tilt the GPS to an angle that suits your flying style. The GPS works very well. You do need to set it up out of the box, but once you do, it'll give you some very useful data, such as distance from home, speed, and altitude. And most importantly, it will allow you to use the GPS rescue function in Betaflight, which can save your quad if you lose your video feed or failsafe. I highly recommend going with GPS if you have the budget for it. Our motors are the Zing ePro 2207 1800 kV motors, and they are designed for 6S. These are budget motors with a steel shaft, but they perform very well, they're reasonably durable, and they're some of the most popular budget motors on the market. The stack is iFlight's Blitz ATF-435 stack with a 55 amp ESC. And if you are wondering where iFlight has made some compromises to bring the price down, it's this stack. This is a $60 stack with a cheaper chip. It's an AT32 MCU. It has an ICM42688 gyro. These were being shipped with BMI 270 gyros, but not anymore. But this stack does have all the features that really count. It has 6 UARTs, 32 megabytes of black box storage, a 9-volt 2-amp BEC to make sure your DJI O3 has plenty of power. And when I'm flying, honestly, I can't tell the difference between a cheap stack and a more expensive stack as long as the quad is tuned well, the gyro is functioning well, and the flight controller has all the features I need when it's on the bench. Unless you're an expert pilot, honestly, I don't think you'll be able to notice any difference on a drone running a cheaper stack like this one. What does really matter is durability. iFlight had these stacks on sale during a Black Friday sale, and I grabbed a few of them, and I have them in some other builds, and so far I don't have any complaints. Keep in mind this Nazgul Eco is a very popular drone, so unless you start seeing reports online of these electronics failing and Nazgul Ecos falling out of the sky, I think it's safe to say that this stack is fairly reliable. All right, you guys, let's talk about some of the differences between the Nazgul Eco, the non-Eco version of the Nazgul, and the Nazgul Evoque. The non-Eco version of the Nazgul is basically the same, but it's using an F7 flight controller. From what I can see on iFlight's product page, as of the making of this video at least, it is using the Zing ePro motors, but it costs about $120 more. Personally, I'd rather spend that money on Crossfire and GPS upgrades, or a new GoPro, or whatever. Now let's talk about the Nazgul Evoque. This is an older Evoque that has the original Zing motors and the original DJI system. The difference between the Evoque and the Nazgul Eco is basically the flight controller. This is going to have an F7 flight controller. The motors are higher end on the Evoque, and also the Evoque has these side plates with some extra bling. And I have to admit, it does look pretty cool, but the price difference is significant. This Evoque will run you $200 more. Well, actually now $180 more after they adjusted that price. Again, I would prefer to save the money. It really comes down to what your budget and priorities are, but it's nice to have options. What do you guys think? Is it worth it to save the money by going with the Nazgul Eco and its cheaper electronics, or would you splash out and get the Nazgul Evoque? iFlight recommends using a 1400 milliamp 6S battery, which they say will get you 7.5 minutes of hover time. I don't own any 1400 milliamp packs, but I do have loads of these 1300 milliamp and 1500 milliamp packs, and they work great on this quad. Without a battery, my Nazgul Eco weighs in at 462 grams. iFlight lists this as weighing 450 grams, so they must not have included the GPS. With a 1300 milliamp 6S battery and a battery strap, it weighs in at just over 700 grams. And with a 1500 milliamp battery and a battery strap, it weighs about 733 grams. In real-world flight conditions, my 1300 milliamp packs were giving me about 5 to 5.5 minutes, and my 1500 milliamp packs were giving me about 6 to 6.5 minutes. Now, those flight times will be a little bit less if I'm flying hard, or if I run a GoPro, I get about a minute less. Your mileage will vary according to your flying style, and keep in mind, my batteries are not new. Brand new batteries might last a little bit longer. I've built my last 3 5-inch drones myself, and I forget how nice it is to just crack open a box, bind your radio, and get to flying. My Nazgul Eco flies super smooth. It's ideal for freestyle or the kind of cinematic cruising flights that I like to do. I don't really have anything bad to say about the way it flies. The tune is very good. I'm not seeing any jello in my FPV footage or my DJI O3 DVR footage. iFlight has really delivered a very capable quad at a fair price with the Nazgul Eco. All right, you guys, here's what the Nazgul Eco looks like when it comes to you. And here's what you get in the box. We get two sets of these iFlight Nazgul F5 propellers. These are 5.1 inch props with 3.5 pitch. We get a bag full of accessories, two battery straps, one is already installed on the drone, two anti-slip battery mats. We get two 60 millimeter antennas. These are iFlight's Albatross version 2 antennas, which are supposed to be lighter weight and perform a little bit better than their version 1 antennas. They are left-hand circular polarized. And we got some screws, some prop nuts, and a screw for your GoPro mount. Underneath the drone, we've got some stickers and documentation, including some very handy quick start guides on how to set up your GPS and some information about your receiver. Sticker pack's pretty cool too. And finally, the drone itself. It's absolutely covered in warning stickers, and that's nice to see because you can tell that iFlight is making a real effort to make it as easy as possible to set up this drone for beginners. And when you're new to the hobby, that learning curve can be really tough, and you don't really start having fun until you figure everything out. So it's nice to see iFlight making an effort to get people into FPV. Setting up this quad in Betaflight was about as easy as setting up an FPV drone can be. Mine came with Betaflight 4.5.0. The quad does come set up with angle mode activated by default, as we were told by one of those handy stickers. If you're a beginner, you might want to practice an angle mode until you feel comfortable, then switch to horizon mode, and finally work your way up to acro mode. For experienced pilots, you're going to have to add acro mode. Under the motors tab, it is set up with props out. I usually fly props in, so I switch that just so I won't be constantly putting on my props backward in the field. It is running DShot 600, and it does have bidirectional DShot enabled. Here's what the OSD looks like when you get your Nazgul Eco. My usual OSD setup is a little bit different, but I actually like the way iFlight puts the GPS info at the bottom center of the screen. It's completely natural for me to have your direction and distance from home dead center like that, so I kept that part and added all of the OSD elements that I'm used to. GPS rescue is turned off by default, as indicated in that handy setup card, so you do have to set it up. Here's how I set up my GPS. I changed failsafe to GPS rescue. I changed minimum satellites from 5 to 6. I do activate allow arming without fix. This just allows the quad to arm even if it doesn't get enough satellites, which is the way I want it for my testing purposes. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to do my hover test. If you do have a drone with GPS and your quad won't arm, that might be why. I also set my GPS rescue switch to hold at a value where it's activated so that if I do fail safe and I can't activate the switch, it'll be activated automatically. That's about it. There's not much to it. If your Nazgul Eco is equipped with GPS, I recommend you test out GPS rescue in a safe place like an open field where you can hover low over grass or somewhere you can recover your quad and it won't get damaged in case you don't have it set up properly and it decides to drop out of the sky. Trust me, I've built dozens of drones and I've made every mistake imaginable. When you consider the cost of the DJI O3 Air Unit alone, this drone is really a very good value. You're getting a high quality iFlight bind and fly for not very much money. And if you're an analog flyer, well, even better, because the TrueX version of this drone is about as cheap as an FPV drone can be. The build quality of this drone is very, very good, and it doesn't feel like a cheap drone. iFlight has added a lot of the extras that they're known for, like an anti-spark filter, an external buzzer, an LED light that lights up that logo, and 3D printed parts throughout. I also really like the power system. I've bought these Xing ePro motors for other builds, not just because they're cheap, but because they perform very well and they're pretty durable. The Nazgul Eco has plenty of power to rip around. You can fly freestyle if that's your thing, and you can lift a GoPro without even noticing the weight. The only reasons I can think of why you wouldn't want the Nazgul Eco, first, if you have to have high-end electronics, you're gonna wanna look at an Evoque or the non-eco version of the Nazgul. Or second, if you're just getting started in FPV and you don't feel comfortable yet flying a super powerful open prop drone like this, I would recommend you spend some time on the simulator first, or you look at something smaller with prop protection and then you work up to something like this Nazgul Eco. If you do decide that this quad is for you, there are some links in the video description below. All right, you guys, thanks a lot for watching. I'll see you in the next one. We'll be right back.